Hello, welcome back to Chartwell Booksellers. We are still closed to customers, unfortunately, but we have been coming in more and more to deal with our online orders and phone orders, and it is sustaining us, and I thank you very much for that. The publication of a new Churchill-related book, As Good As the Daughters of Yalta by Catherine Katz, has prompted us to hazard this webcast. Catherine Katz is in the house, and she will remove her mask very shortly to share her fine new book with you. Catherine holds degrees in history from Harvard and Cambridge and is currently pursuing her JD at Harvard Law School. As if that isn't enough activity, she's also written this marvelous book, which examines the Yalta Conference from a very unique perspective. In fact, three unique perspectives, those of FDR's daughter, Anna, Averill Harriman's daughter, Kathleen, and Winston Churchill's daughter, Sarah, who each accompanied their respective fathers to the conference and viewed that conference as really no one else could. It is a fascinating angle from which to view history, and because of Catherine Katz, we get to share it. Let me just share with you that Catherine once worked in this building upstairs. She came down here regularly to visit and browse our shelves, and her literary triumph is a source of pride for all of us. So ladies and gentlemen, all of you out there in the ether, I give you Catherine Katz and the Daughters of Yalta.
Thank you, Barry, for that very kind introduction, and thank you so much for putting this event together during these challenging times. Bookstores like Chartwell are truly the heart and soul of the reading and writing community, and we are so lucky to have this jewel right here in the heart of Manhattan. This book is an example of one of those moments in life where different threads of your life that don't seem to be connected all come together in a unique way. I always loved history. I grew up on movies like The Sound of Music and White Christmas and The Great Escape, these wonderful stories about World War II. I used to chase my grandfather around at Thanksgiving with a notepad asking him to tell me stories about his experience in the Navy during World War II. So I think it was pretty clear what I wanted to be when I grew up from the time I was very young. My favorite stories were Little House on the Prairie and Anne of Green Gables and A Little Princess, and I liked to imagine myself in the times of these young women I was reading about in, you know, fiction and nonfiction. But one of the threads that connected all of them was that these were girls who wanted to grow up to be writers. And that's what I always wanted to do. I just never thought I'd be lucky enough to be able to do that at this point in my life. Churchill came into my life somewhat serendipitously, but despite my great interest in World War II, it was actually not Churchill as Prime Minister with whom I first became acquainted, but actually Churchill as a young man during the Boer War. I was writing my thesis in college about prisoner of war escape attempts, and I was fascinated by the story of Churchill's own escape from a Boer POW camp when he was a young man. And the story of his thrilling escape really rocketed him to fame and began his political career in Britain. My second foray into Churchillian studies was again serendipitous, but again not related to World War II. I was looking at the origins of modern counterintelligence practices for my graduate dissertation at Cambridge, and many of the practices that are still in place today were pioneered by Churchill as Home Secretary during the First World War. After Cambridge, I knew that I wanted to someday continue with history and writing. I just didn't know how at that time. And so, like many people right out of school, I decided to do what I thought was the smart thing and the sensible thing. So I took a job in finance here in New York, right upstairs in this building. And it was very fortuitous when I came down to the lobby to get a coffee one day and noticed that right here in this building where I worked was this wonderful bookstore called Chartwell, named after Churchill's country home. So multiple times a week when I'd come down for coffee, I would stop at the store, look at the wonderful treasures here, and over time I got to know Barry and we got to chatting, and I think it was perhaps a bit unique at that time to see, you know, a young female analyst come in so often with this great interest in Churchill. And after many visits, Barry suggested that I should meet the International Churchill Society, which coincidentally was having a dinner across the street at the Waldorf featuring Madeleine Albright. And he said, you know, perhaps they need some help at the dinner. I said, that would be great. So off I went. And there I met the International Churchill Society, which is made up of people from Churchill family members to academics to people in various professions who are all fascinated by history, want to encourage the study of history, especially the life and times of Churchill, and use his example of public leadership and public service to inspire a new generation of people to go into public service. Shortly after the dinner, the Churchill family was opening the papers of Winston's middle daughter, Sarah, to outside researchers for the first time, and the International Churchill Society asked if I'd be interested in writing an article about her papers for their journal, Finest Hour. I didn't know much about Sarah at the time, other than she was the middle daughter of Winston and Clementine Churchill. She had been in a movie called Royal Wedding, where she starred opposite Fred Astaire in 1951, and if people know anything about her, that's usually what they know. But I had had this early life experience with Sarah that came back to my mind at that moment. Every summer since I was little, my family has gone to the cloister at Sea Island, Georgia, and on the wall is a picture of Sarah Churchill on her wedding day in 1949. She had eloped to Sea Island with her second husband, and this beautiful picture of her at her wedding had been on the wall, and I'd walked past it every single summer since I was a year old. So I was thrilled to work on this, very excited to go back to Cambridge where the papers were stored. And as I got to know more about Sarah, I became fascinated by this very complex and unique person who I wanted to know more about. Sarah was born in 1914. She was very shy as a young woman. And yet, despite this shyness, she was very close to her father. She felt that she understood him, even if she wasn't speaking to him directly, and she would spend hours at his side, engaged in one of his favorite pastimes at Chartwell, which was laying bricks for brick walls, and she was his assistant. They'd pass many hours in quiet harmony. Despite her shyness, she was a woman who was, she had a great deal of spirit, much like her father. She had great political savvy and was a beautiful writer. She was extremely stubborn. Her family nickname was Mule. And she truly wanted to make her own way in the world and her mark on the world. She didn't want to be a debutante, which was expected of a woman of her class and position. But for a woman at that time, like Sarah, there weren't many careers open to her. And the one thing that she thought that she might do was become an actress and a dancer, which was at first a bit jarring to her family. But after a while, her father came around to the idea, perhaps because she reminded him somewhat of his own mother, the American debutante Jenny Jerome, who occasionally scandalized polite society with her romances and forays into writing plays for the stage. He was not so thrilled with Sarah's decision soon after to fall in love with the star of her show, a man named Vic Oliver, who was considerably older than she was. She eloped with him to America, part of her father's concern that he was an Austrian national and the winds of change in Europe were presenting themselves at this time. But by the time the war broke out, the marriage had broken down. And when her father became prime minister, Sarah realized that she wanted to do her bit for the war effort as well. And she didn't want to do it making use of her father's connections, but on her own. So she enlisted as an officer in the Women's Auxiliary Air Force, part of the Royal Air Force, where she became an aerial reconnaissance intelligence officer. And Sarah, through her work, became intimately informed about the smallest details of Allied operations, especially in the Mediterranean. And sometimes she even knew the details of these operations better than her father, much to their shared amusement. Earlier in the war, the Churchill family had decided that whenever Winston traveled abroad, someone from the family should accompany him as a protector and confidant of sorts, but also as an unofficial family historian to preserve the record for posterity. And thanks to Sarah's experience as a WAF and through her training as an actress, which lent itself extremely well to diplomacy, Sarah was the perfect choice to join her father first at the Tehran Conference in 1943, the first meeting of the Big Three, Churchill, FDR, and Stalin. And it was at this conference that several other people realized what a great asset she was to her father, these people being the American ambassador to the Soviet Union, Avril Harriman, and President Roosevelt himself. When it came time for the Yalta Conference in February 1945, they too decided to bring their daughters to the conference as their aides. Now, I had studied Yalta many times in school. However, I had no idea that these three women had been at the conference. There's an iconic photograph of the Big Three seated in the courtyard at Levadia Palace in Yalta on the Black Sea in the Crimea. Behind them stand military officers. But there's another photograph with a slightly different frame, and you can see off to the side in the background three young women standing under a portico. This is Sarah, Kathleen and Anna. The Yalta Conference is one of the most important moments of the 20th century. It's also a controversial flashpoint on the precipice between World War II and the Cold War. At Yalta, there were four main issues on the table. First, with the end of the war in sight in Europe, finally at long last, and the armies racing from east and west to see who would be the first to liberate Berlin, there's a question about what to do about Germany in the war's aftermath. They had instigated two world wars. Should they be allowed to remain a contiguous nation and perhaps risk becoming a belligerent once again in the future, or should they be broken into smaller entities? Second was a very difficult diplomatic issue that the Soviets and the Western Allies found themselves on opposite sides. This was the issue of guaranteeing Polish sovereignty. Britain had gone to war to defend Polish sovereignty at the outset, and while Stalin said that he was committed to this as well, the Red Army was in control across the ground throughout Poland, and since the Tsarist era, the Soviet Union and Russia before had been concerned about having friendly neighbors on their borders. They'd been invaded through Poland multiple times and were determined that the post-war government in Poland would be friendly to their interests in Moscow. Third was the issue of how to bring the Soviets into the war in the Pacific. The Soviets and Japan had had a pact of neutrality throughout the war, and at this time the Americans did not yet know if the atomic bomb would be a success. Iwo Jima had not yet occurred, and so Roosevelt was looking at potentially an invasion of the home islands that could put at risk the lives of 200,000 American servicemen. He was determined to save as many American lives as possible, and the way to do this, he thought, was to bring the Soviets into the war in exchange for territorial concessions. Finally, there's the matter of forming a peace organization of United Nations. Roosevelt was determined to succeed where Woodrow Wilson had failed at the end of World War I, and while he was not so naive to think that you could guarantee a lasting peace for all time, he did want to create a peace in Europe, especially for at least 50 years. And through an organization like the United Nations, he also believed that he could bring the Soviet Union into the post-war international order. But Yalta is also the moment that something fundamentally changes in the Allied relationship. As the Soviet Union has the Red Army firmly in control throughout Eastern Europe, Stalin is in a position where his allies need him much more than he needs them, and he's willing to exploit tensions between his allies to secure what he wants. So it's in this tense geopolitical environment, one of the most delicate of the last 5 years, that these three women found themselves, and I was fascinated by how they got there. We've spoken a bit about Sarah. A person that I'm very excited to introduce readers to is Kathleen Harriman. She was the youngest of the three women at 27 years old. She was born in 1917 to a very prominent family in New York. She was the younger daughter of Kitty Lanier Lawrence and William Averill Harriman, known as Averill Harriman, who was the son of the railroad magnate, self-made millionaire, and Union Pacific chairman E.H. Harriman. Averill Harriman would go on to become one of the wise men of the Cold War, the governor of New York and a Democratic presidential candidate. But like his father before him, he was also the chairman of Union Pacific and a captain of industry in shipping and mining and media. He was a polo champion, and he even was the founder of Sun Valley and was one of the main forces to bring skiing to America. Americans had fallen in love with skiing after the Lake Placid Olympics in 1932, and Harriman realized he had a wonderful opportunity to increase business on his Western Railroad lines by giving them a glamorous ski destination rivaling those in Europe in the Alps. And it's also thanks to Averill Harriman and his engineers at Union Pacific that we had the first chairlift. Harriman set aside his business career in the 1930s at the urging of his sister, Mary Harriman Rumsey, who was one of the top women in FDR's New Deal administration. And it was perhaps this connection with his sister that led him to have this unique relationship with his daughter. Like her father, Kathleen was a tremendous athlete. She was an Olympic-level skier, an expert equestrian, and a crack shot. She was a glamorous brunette and extremely adventurous. She and her father did not have a terribly close relationship when she was a child. Her parents divorced when she was 10, and it wasn't until her mother passed away when she was a teenager that she and her father found their way back together, initially through this shared love of sport and adventure. Kathleen would spend her school vacations and college in Sun Valley helping her father. And when the war broke out and her father was appointed Roosevelt's lend-lease envoy in Britain, using his business experience to oversee the assistance to Britain of war material and other aid while the United States remained neutral, He realized it could be a great opportunity for Kathleen as well, and so he decided in the middle of a blitz that Kathleen should try to come to London with him, and he asked his friend Harry Hopkins to help her secure a visa to come to London as a war reporter. If people know Kathleen, it's because of this time she spent in London at the beginning of the war and the friendship she and her father found with the Churchill family. The Harrimans had become very close friends with the Churchills, such that on December 7th, 1941, they were celebrating Kathleen's 24th birthday when they realized that Pearl Harbor had been attacked. But it was also an open secret at this time that Averill Harriman was having an affair with Pamela Churchill, the wife of Winston's son, Randolph, and she was 2 years younger than Kathleen. Kathleen agreed to keep their affair a secret, as it helped her secure her place in London, even if the situation turned increasingly dangerous. But stopping here belies Kathleen's true historical importance. In 1943, FDR appointed Averill the ambassador to the Soviet Union, and Kathy decided that she wanted to remain with him through the end of the war. She joined him in Moscow, where she learned Russian, and truly became his assistant ambassador and, in a sense, a chief protocol officer. And the relationship by this time was really one that was more like that between colleagues than between parent and child. And throughout this fascinating experience she had in Moscow, Kathleen became the American woman who had more experience and interaction with Stalin and his inner circle than any other American woman in history. Finally, there's Anna Roosevelt. At 38 and a mother of three, Anna was the oldest of the three women. She was tall, blonde, had a terrific sense of humor. She was the oldest child and only daughter of Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt, and growing up, she and her father were extremely close, really united by this shared love of nature and the outdoor world. They'd spend long afternoons together riding through the fields and the woods around their home in Hyde Park, New York. But FDR's paralysis from polio changed this relationship significantly. After that, she was sent away to school. Her parents, despite their very liberal attitude, wanted her to become a debutante, like it was expected of women of her age. And like Sarah Churchill, this was something that she rejected. She spent a short time at Cornell before leaving at 20 years old and made a very rebellious marriage to a man named Curtis Dahl. She and Curtis had two children, but sadly the marriage didn't last. And Anna caused a bit of a scandal shortly thereafter when she fell in love with a Republican journalist named Joan Buttiger, who was employed by one of FDR's chief critics, William Randolph Hearst. They set aside any political differences and smoothed things over and married and moved to Seattle, where they took charge of one of Hearst's papers called the Seattle Post-Intelligencer, where they edited it together. Anna had her third child, but shortly thereafter, John decided to join the army, and he shipped out to the Mediterranean. And rather remain in Seattle on her own, Anna decided to move home to the White House. But almost immediately after arriving there, she noticed something was not right about her father. Her mother didn't seem too concerned, but Anna noticed that he was staring off into space for long periods of time, sitting with his mouth hanging open and just not quite as sharp on details as she remembered. Despite her mother's lack of concern, Anna decided to insist upon a comprehensive medical examination. FDR never asked his doctor the results of this exam. He did not want to know any of his medical information, and Eleanor similarly remained somewhat removed from the situation. So it fell to Anna to take on this knowledge from the doctor that her father was in fact dying of congestive heart failure, for which there was no cure, and without dramatic changes to his lifestyle, he did not have long to live. So Anna took it upon herself to keep her father alive. She began to take papers out of his inbox at night and distribute them to others who might handle it instead. She began to guard who could have a meeting with the president, deciding who really needed his attention and his audience, and who could meet with someone else. Some people admired her for this active role they knew she was taking, though they didn't know why. However, many didn't, including Harry Hopkins, who had long been this person at Roosevelt's side and perhaps felt concerned about this new presence in the White House. For years, throughout the war and during his international travels, FDR had relied on his sons to travel with him to help him physically on these voyages, to help him stand, to move from his chair, to help him write himself, to make a speech. And for years, Anna had begged to be able to come on one of these conferences travels. And for years, FDR said no. However, this time, even though he didn't know what was wrong with him, he sensed something was different. And so this time, is he was looking at preparations for the Yalta Conference in the winter of 1945. He cabled his friend Winston Churchill and said, "If you're thinking of bringing Sarah to this conference, I'm considering bringing my daughter Anna as well." So Anna finally had her chance to join her father for an overseas voyage, as she had long wanted to do. What of Stalin, people wonder? Stalin did have a daughter. Her name was Svetlana. She was 19. And she was married and pregnant with her first child. Svetlana and her father had a very contentious relationship. She did speak English and could have been a great asset to him at a conference such as this. However, he restricted her access to foreigners constantly. She met Winston Churchill one time, but otherwise was largely kept out of the way. And when she decided to marry Grigory Morozov, her father was very upset. Morozov was Jewish, and he never met his son-in-law. So though I had learned about the geopolitics of Yalta in class many times, as I started to read about these women, it helped me begin to see a much more personal side to these great moments in history that we think we know so well. These women were between 27 and 38 years old. I was 27 as I was working on this book, and I began to think, what would it be like to be this age and to be Kathleen Harriman, for example, and to be on the other side of the world in the middle of a war and to be asked to get up and give a toast in Russian in front of Stalin and Lavrentiy Beria and Vyacheslav Molotov and some of the biggest names and most fearsome individuals in history. And it made me realize that even at the height of geopolitics and diplomacy, these leaders, these great men of history, you know, in capital letters, they're still people with their joys and their sorrows and their biases and foibles and loves and fears. And at the end of the day, these great men of history, they're also someone's dad. And what would it be like to be their child? At this time, I'd been working in finance for about 2 years, and while it was a great opportunity and I learned many useful skills, the more time I spent with this material in this return to history, I remembered what I had truly wanted to do as a child, and this was my passion. And so with law school in the back of my mind, I decided to take a chance, and fortunately, the timing was perfect. New sources had allowed this very personal side of the story to be told. For example, Sarah's letters to her mother from Yalta, which the family had just made available. Sarah also had extensive correspondence with her sister Mary. Those letters were not yet available, but the family kindly made them available to me to do this research. Kathleen Harriman had died in 2011, and like many in her generation, she did not speak about her remarkable experience during World War II. And so it was only after she died, when her sons discovered a box of letters to her sister in her apartment, that they really began to understand their mother in a different way. She had extensive correspondence with her sister throughout her time in London and Moscow, and it was in these letters her personality truly shines through. And finally, there are Anna's letters, which are at the FDR Presidential Library in New York, as well as a diary, which was interesting because Anna had promised her father when she moved into the White House that she wouldn't keep a diary so that everything between them would remain confidential. Anna was truly the secret keeper for her father, not just about his health, but for several other significant secrets as well. And she knew, though, at the conference that she was living through a truly unique moment in history, and she wanted to record this for posterity, but also to be able to share the small details with her husband and her children when she returned home. Finally, writing this book at this time was also a thrilling experience because it allowed me to speak with people who had known these women at this time. I was able to interview Anna Roosevelt's children, who are in their 80s and 90s, one of whom was a teenager during the war and remembers all the details so clearly. I spoke with Kathleen Harriman's sons, David and Avi Mortimer, who were so forthcoming and generous with their time and their memories of their mother. While Sarah Churchill never had any children, she was very close to her nieces, who I was so fortunate to speak with, as well as Lady Jane Williams, who was one of Churchill's secretaries, who is also the mother of the Archbishop of Canterbury and has had a fascinating front row seat to history. As his letters revealed to me, each of these women shared something very similar and special. They each desperately wanted to be the person that their fathers relied on in these crucial moments in history. And this was something that they had wanted since childhood. For so many women, the war opened a window of opportunity, and it was one that they knew was only going to be open for a short period of time. And yet, you know, when the world changed again and they were once again on the outside looking in, it was almost, this moment was enough to give them this satisfaction of this relationship that they had wanted with their fathers since they were little girls. And not only do the daughters shed a new and far more personal light on these stories of history, the summit of history, these moments that we think we know so well, it also helps us better understand Yalta from a different perspective, which can inform questions that we struggle with in our own world today. First, there's the question of how to deal with Russia in international diplomacy. It's a difficult balance for the American leader to strike of keeping friends close and enemies closer, especially without alienating one's allies. And through the experience of Anna at the Yalta conference, you can see this very strong desire that FDR had to be able to form a personal relationship with Stalin. He thought that this would be the breakthrough to bring the Soviet Union into the community of nations. Unfortunately, this did not turn out to be the case, and since then, subsequent American presidential administrations have pursued a similar line of reasoning as recently as the Bush, Obama, and Trump administrations, albeit the latter from a slightly different perspective. And is, you know, this attempt to try to form a personal relationship one that we can rely on, or perhaps should we try a different approach going forward? And second, as this election cycle has shown, the political and the personal are intimately intertwined. They say when you marry someone, you marry their family. And for better or for worse, it does seem to some extent when you elect someone, you elect their family. In a sense, it's only natural that in moments of crisis where you need to consult your conscience, you want to talk to the people closest to you. And if you're the president, often that is your family. So it, you know, leads us to think, what is the appropriate role for a first family? The first spouse is somewhat well-defined, but the role of the first children, especially adult first children, is one that we haven't really thought about in many years, largely because the most recent presidents have had young children in the White House. And so it's only recently, especially in this administration, that we began to consider this differently. Prior to Ivanka Trump, the most controversial and active first daughter was considered to be Alice Roosevelt Longworth. However, Anna Roosevelt gives us a very different model for a modern first daughter for us to consider. Finally, I think that, you know, it goes without saying that we're living through very challenging times, but in these moments of adversity, I hope that we can look back at history and see not only similar challenge, but also hope. In just the last century, we've endured war, pandemic, depression, war again, the dawn of the nuclear age. And while there is much in history that should give us pause, there's also a lot we can learn about ourselves, as well as much of which we can be proud. And while we still have a lot of work to do, by looking back, we can also see how far we've come. This moment in history in which we're living today reminds me somewhat of the occasion on which Winston Churchill delivered remarks following Neville Chamberlain's death in 1940 about his controversial legacy. Chamberlain's last years were mired in controversy surrounding his attempts to negotiate with Hitler to avoid war, cries of appeasement, but Churchill realized that Chamberlain's legacy would be complex. And he said in November 1940, and this is perhaps a longer passage than I would normally give, but given the audience, I think perhaps it would be appreciated. He says, "It's not given to human beings, happily for them, to properly evaluate themselves within their own times. For otherwise, it would be intolerable to foresee or to predict to any large extent the unfolding course of events. In one phase, men seem to have been right. In another, they seem to have been wrong. And then again, a few years later, when the perspective of time has lengthened, all stands in a different setting. There is a new proportion. There is another scale of values. History, with its flickering lamp, stumbles along the trail of the past, trying to reconstruct its scenes, to revive its echoes, and kindle with pale gleams the passion of former days. What is the worth of all this? The only guide to a man is his conscience. The only shield to his memory is the rectitude and sincerity of his actions. It is very imprudent to walk through life without this shield, because we are so often mocked by the failure of our hopes and the upsetting of our calculations. But with this shield, however the fates may play, we march always in the ranks of honor." So I hope that by viewing the past through this new perspective of these Daughters of Yalta, we may begin to illuminate the darker shadows of history that have lain just off this well-trodden path and lain just out of view. And now with a broader perspective that cuts across gender and generations, I hope that we can sharpen the picture of what happened before to move forward better together. Thank you very much for your time, and I look forward to your questions.
I have no doubt it would be. It was terrific.
Well, thank you very much for having me.
Well, you know, it's nice to have you back.
Thank you.
I'm a little curious. I know that this began to some degree as a Sarah Churchill biography, and mm-hmm. then you changed paths.
Mm-hmm.
If you could just tell me quickly what changed your mind about doing the Sarah biography.
I think the more time I spent doing the research and reading about her life, if people know about her life, it's largely about what happened after the war, her time as an actress, and then she very tragically experienced a number of, you know, personal setbacks later in life, her, you know, death of two of her husbands and, you know, her father shortly thereafter. And so I really wanted to give people an opportunity to see her in a different light, especially her experience during the war, which I thought was truly remarkable and one that is very poorly understood. And the more time I spent reading about her war experience, the more fascinated I was by her attendance at these conferences, which is something really you don't see anywhere else in history. And, you know, not only had she been at Tehran and Yalta, but her presence at Tehran inspired these other two fathers to bring their daughters to Yalta, which was something I thought was quite ahead of their time. And fortunately, the Churchill family was able to put me in touch with Kathleen Harriman's family, and through them, I connected with Anna Roosevelt's children. And it was, you know, the more research I did, the more opportunities presented themselves, and the more I got to know these women.
How close did the women remain after Yalta?
They did not remain especially close friends. The Harrimans and the Churchills would kind of always be intertwined because of the relationship between Averill and Pamela, and many years after the war, after Averill's wife Marie passed away and Pamela was a widow, they married, and so Kathleen's one-time best friend became her stepmother, and so...
The age demographics on that entire relationship literally flipped me.
Yes.
As I was reading about them again.
Yes.
With her witness, you know, and gossiping about her own father's mistress.
So that's
her age.
Yes, so that's definitely very interesting. And so that there was this connection between the Churchills and the Harrimans that, you know, continues long past Yalta. But there were moments where the daughters kind of came back together because of similar life experience. After Sarah's second husband committed suicide, Anna wrote her a letter having experienced something like that herself, expressing her sympathy, also reaching out as someone who understood the position she was in, and knowing Sarah would be having a lot of scrutiny of the press and outsiders, just really connecting with her in a way that she hadn't since Yalta and on a very human and personal level.
Now, I also was fascinated by the presence of Anna and the control she exerted over who got to see her father and who didn't in
yes.
the course of the conference.
Mm-hmm.
I was a little bit horrified by some of the things she was doing, although as we've talked about, I'm also sympathetic to her reasons for doing them.
Mm-hmm.
But we've talked about this a little bit before. Do you think history might have changed in terms of what her father would have accomplished at Yalta if Harry Hopkins, let's say, hadn't been so isolated from her mm-hmm. by Anna and others, simply because she was worried about their impact on his health. But nonetheless, what do you think?
It's difficult. I think Yalta is one of these moments in history that is just surrounded by so many counterfactuals, you know, what if this, what if that. And it's tempting to go down that path, but also very unsatisfying. I think Anna, she's in a very difficult position, and my heart truly goes out to her because she is carrying this burden alone, and she is physically trying to keep him alive. And so if she hadn't run interference to the extent that she had, it's possible, you know, he may have died at Yalta, or he may have been extremely sick and would not have been able to carry on his work throughout the entirety of the conference. And so from that perspective, what she's doing is admirable and perhaps a benefit to history. But on the other hand, getting in the way sometimes of Churchill's attempts to meet with Roosevelt before they meet with Stalin to come up with a united front to present to him before going into the conference room, knowing what a wily negotiator he is. Perhaps history would have been different had they been able to present this united front.
You know, it occurs to me, even as I'm listening to you speak about it, that wasn't her responsibility.
No, I mean, FDR could have.
FDR,
and so I think
he shut them out. Or he allowed
yes.
her to
yes.
shut them out.
So she, in a way, takes the fall for what he yes. is trying to do or not to do, and yet it's not a fair position for her to be in at all.
No. I withdraw the question. You mentioned, though, that in her diary she, or maybe not just in the diary, but that she also kept some other secrets. What were they?
Yes, so the primary secret she was keeping was about her father's affair with Lucy Mercer. And this is something that she struggles with. You know, she doesn't want to betray her mother, knowing how devastating it was for her mother when she first learned of the affair when Anna was a child. And it's something that had been a moment where she and her mother bonded over this when Anna was a teenager, learning about this and the hurt that she had suffered. But Anna, again, with this knowledge that her father is dying, wants to do anything she can to provide him some comfort and solace and perhaps a bit of relief from the pressures he faces all the time. And so she feels that, you know, at this point in his life, that their affair is, you know, more of an emotional one, more of a friendship. And so she justifies it in her head that, you know, she's an adult, her parents are adults, and, you know, who is she to say what's right and what's not? And, you know, we can argue about whether that is, you know, the right way to think or not. It's a distance from one's own parents, which is very interesting. But she was doing that, you know, in, she hoped, service to a greater cause, much like she was doing in, you know, running interference at Yalta, and it was purely from a place of trying to keep her father alive.
And that was the central point. That was the reason.
Yes.
Let's just say that both, two of these daughters had to grapple with fathers having extramarital affairs.
Yes.
Not Winston Churchill.
Not Winston Churchill, no.
Sarah had to deal with that on her own, but not with Winston.
No, and I think that Sarah also, at these conferences, you know, she knew how devoted her parents were to each other. And while Clementine understood Winston better than anyone, I think Sarah, after Clementine, was the one who could speak with her father and help him think through complicated issues and let him kind of talk it out himself in front of a secure audience before going into a conference room, so he could present the best version of what he wanted to say.
That's excellent. He was very comfortable.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What was the most surprising thing, if you could nail one thing that you uncovered from this book that took your breath away?
I think it's the level of interconnectedness between all of these families. I mean, we think about kind of some of the post-war level connections, you know, the affair between Pamela and April Harriman, of course, but even at Yalta, you know, these connections between, you know, for example, the Hopkins family and their family. Harry Hopkins also brings his son to the conference as a photographer. And then Leventry Beria, who is the head of, you know, the NKVD, he also brings his son, although no one knows he's there. And so you have these multi-generational experiences there, and the three daughters do interact with Harry Hopkins' son, and so it's just a very unique look, and is just so personal to see the conference from the eyes of, you know, these adult children who understand what's going on and are really there. You think in a way perhaps they are kind of working in tandem because they are, you know, the children of the daughters, but they really are there as their father's agents. And, you know, you can see the ebbs and flows of their relationships based on the ebbs and flows of their father's relationships with each other.
Absolutely. But my favorite history is always anything that humanizes these figures, these historical figures, and reminds us that they were people.
Yes.
Which makes their accomplishments all the more extraordinary because they weren't icons. And that's what this book does extraordinarily well. It humanizes that these become, and I'm the father of two daughters, so I'm very sympathetic to fathers and daughters in particular.
Well, I'm hoping that this is a book that will resonate with both fathers and daughters. You know, maybe it's something they will give to each other and read together. And I think that its history is something that has perhaps seemed unapproachable to people. I mean, the Yalta conferences, you know, are at the heights of, you know, the summits of history. And at the end of the day, these people are people, and you can't understand them, and you do sympathize with them, and you understand the position they're in. Maybe not the same feeling of, oh, I know what it's like to sit at this conference table with Stalin on the other side, but I do know what it is to have competing priorities and different interests and needing someone who can understand that implicitly and will be there for you without question. And everybody has that person in their life, and they really kind of are the unsung heroes for all of us. And they don't always get the recognition that they deserve, but I'm really glad to be able to give at least, you know, three really remarkable people this recognition.
That's true. Thank you. And also tell us about the movie.
I can't say anything else about that at this point.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Come again soon.
I will.